Hello, this is Rick Love for Sun TV 27 and the Sonoma International Film Festival Filmmaker Interview Series. We have with us director Greg Garthe and producer financier Spence Jackson of Last Call, which screened last night in the Christopher Lloyd tribute because Mr. Lloyd appeared in your film. Welcome.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Welcome. So how do you, a debut feature, how do you procure an actor like Christopher Lloyd and also Tara Reid and Tom Arnold and some of these big name people to come and be in your film when you're just starting out as first feature?
The Chris Lloyd of it all was lucky through my casting director, Valerie McCaffrey, who had a personal relationship with him, and she was working on something else. We were trying to attach an actor for that role, and we had gone to a few other guys over a couple of months or so, and she was working on something else with him, and she was in the room with him, and she sent me a text or called me and said, "Hey, should I pitch the movie to him?" And I said, "Yeah, please." Mm-hmm. And she got me in the room with him, and we met up for coffee, and we talked, and I told him about my take on the role, and we kind of were on the same page, and so he was into it. And then with Tom and Tara was kind of a... They came on kind of last minute when we had a couple last roles to film. We were still trying to find some name actors to get in there. And we basically were able, at the point where we were a week away from shooting, or just even a few days away from shooting their part.
And you don't know who's going to be saying those lines yet?
No.
Exactly. Yeah. No, there was a few roles that were very last minute. Clint Howard was last minute. And
Tara was actually the very last one that we cast.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And agents take you a little bit more seriously when you say, "Hey, we have this role. We love your client for it. It shoots tomorrow. Come on down." So... and so that's how we wrangled those, a few of the other ones.
Yeah, it's impressive to see. And I'm wondering if it seems like there's been a change in, and I'm not sure if it's agents or if it's getting to actors directly, where 20 years ago, when their independent film was very, very small, pre-Sundance, pre-Sex, Lies, and Videotape, I wonder, is there been a change where people are just more open to being in independent films, some of these big name actors?
I think there's more openness, yeah, to them being in it, but it's not direct. I mean, you still have to deal with all the manager agent chains, and that gets a little bit frustrating at times.
Mm-hmm. And then I would imagine the bigger the star, the more you need to readjust your shooting schedule around when they're available.
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, Tara was a good example of that. We had to put all of her shoot days together. She was on a cruise, or she was on a boat in the Mediterranean or something, and she had to come back, and we had her for a few days, and we had to group them all together. There was actually one scene that she was in, but we had to shoot the scene on a different day, but we shot her side of it when she came. You can't tell at all.
And then just cut it in.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She literally came the day before the shoot from an overseas trip. So
that's right. I mean,
battling jet lag.
So your continuity director earns their money on those days.
Yeah.
So. Absolutely. The feel for your film, it's definitely has kind of a guy movie, buddy comedy feel. Were you thinking of... working in that genre, or did the story come more out of I have these actors, or is it true to life, or where did the story of Last Call come from?
Yeah, I got trained in that genre by my longtime boss and mentor, David Dobkin, who directed Wedding Crashers, and so I kind of grew up an action movie fan, and then the first script I wrote was a kind of a detective mystery, and I was into that genre more, but you know, sometimes you fall into things. David, my boss, fell into comedy by doing comedy commercials. He didn't ever see himself as a comedy director. So the script was written by a friend of mine, and I had written it actually, or he had written it when... or I had read it when I was working on Crashers, and I loved it. And a couple of years later, we started talking more seriously about it, and that kind of just went from there.
Mm-hmm. and you're our first financier this morning. What's it like trying to get, I assume it's a broad range of people and you're going and you're pitching them the idea and what they can expect on the return.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, I probably misspoke. I'm the only investor.
Oh, okay. So there you go. So then Greg comes to you with the idea, and then says, you know, here's my plan. And
actually, he sent out an email to all of his friends, and one of his friends in California sent it to a friend of mine in New York, who sent it to me. And I tell you, it all came together because I was going to be in LA the next week anyway, and it was just interesting enough that I set up a plan to talk with him. And you know, it wasn't like that first meeting I was sold, but you know, we kept talking, and over a couple of months I got into the idea. I had never even had an inkling or a thought of getting into the film business before.
So, really?
Yeah, this was all new to me, but now I'm doing another project and I kind of developed a love for filmmaking.
So is it the idea of the film, or is it this story you see as marketable, or what brings you into the project?
Well, originally it was this story. You know, Greg pitched it as, we're going to create a studio quality film that looks like a $10 or $20 million film for under $1 million. And you know, in a sense, I feel like we did pull that off. But since then, it's become really more of a love of filmmaking itself and the process. Mm-hmm. So I don't know why, it's just probably the creative side of it.
Well, that's great. It's because I would imagine that's the hardest side for you as a director to deal with. I mean, we had a Q&A last night talking about a producer in Canada who had, I guess there were bond things there that they were constantly having, the money side was constantly impacting the creative side.
Yeah, of
even
course.
During the shoot.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's difficult, and movies fall apart all the time. Things get greenlit and then fall apart. You know, I always say the moons have to align in order for a movie to get made at any level, whether it's at a low budget level or at a big studio level. It's still a lot of money, no matter what. You know. Mm-hmm.
It certainly is. So what's next for the film?
Well, we're looking at distribution right now, so we're talking to the formal distributors, and we're talking to the foreign sales reps, and possibly even looking at sort of a limited four-wall plan on our own. So I can't tell you the end result, but
mm-hmm.
obviously I'd like to recoup at least the original investment, if not more.
Certainly. And that, I would imagine, in that those talks with distributors, Christopher Lloyd, Tom Arnold, Tara Reid would be, and they're an important part of that, as well as the story, and as well as that Judd Apatow piece that's out there now, where you can make a raunchy R-rated a movie that has some nudity in it and language, but still has this kind of heart
mm-hmm.
piece
yeah.
that goes together. Yeah. Because you're denouement, for a better word, in Dublin, where you get to see this, you realize that it's been, there's a heart piece to this. It's not Porky's.
Yeah.
There's trying to have these characters have there be an arc and have them come out better people at the end, I guess.
Actually, what I think is one of the best parts of the film is there's kind of a subplot that deals with the relationship between the two young males and their girlfriends. And it kind of gives it a little bit more heart and probably appeals more to a female audience, not just the male audience.
Mm-hmm. Certainly. And I love the regulars, the old guys at the bar. And seeing Clint Howard up there as an old Gentle Ben fan myself.
You.
He is that guy. If you look at his filmography.
It's crazy.
And how is it to work with, were those scenes all grouped together as well? Or was that, because they were in a lot of scenes in the film.
Some of it was.
Yeah.
All of it.
I think they were kind of spread out over the schedule. But yeah, they all had a lot of days. I think that those guys were like on for 9 or 10 or 11 days.
Mm-hmm.
Each.
By the way, Clint and I have gotten to be good friends over the last few years, and we're actually working on another project right now called The Other Brother.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting. Clint Howard, Christopher Lloyd, both of these guys, both known for kind of playing these unhinged characters, and that's, you know, you have that. And I would imagine for him being able to look at, I mean, just reviewing his reel from last night, as you see, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and Doc Brown, and Uncle Fester, and your character, the grandfather, is very much in line with kind of this unhinged piece. Yet at the end, he's this calm guy reading an anger management book.
Yeah, you know? That's the way it was on the set. You sit there talking to him about fishing, and he'd go off and do one of these scenes that just requires so much intensity. It was amazing.
Well, congratulations on a strong debut, and thank you very much for coming and talking with us today.
Thank you very much.
The film is Last Call. Producer and financier Spence Jackson and director Greg Garthe. It is playing on Saturday at 12:45 at Murphy's Pub. So pull a pint while you're there.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.